Morning, we begin our study. As you see, I was told this screen up here is not really working very well, so if it blinks out, hey, what can I say? This one here is supposed to work, so I'll be reading off that. I'm hoping you'll be able to follow along up there. But we're beginning our study on the Bible and homosexual conduct. And in this first class, and I suspect into the next, I'm going to be introducing the subject. Now, this will highlight the importance of the study, and it'll explain the particular focus that I'm taking, as will become clear when I talk about it. But unless you just awoke from a 10-year coma, you know that homosexuals and their allies are aggressively pushing the claim that the church should, even must, receive into its fellowship those who are actively and impenitently engaged in homosexual conduct. For example, in his recent book, just from earlier in 2014, Matthew Vines, in his book, God and the Gay Christian, he says, as more believers are coming to realize, affirming our gay brothers and sisters, by which he means affirming their same-sex relationships as moral. That's the entire burden of his book. Okay, he says, as more believers are coming to realize, affirming our gay brothers and sisters isn't simply one possible path Christians can take. It isn't just a valid option. This kind of love and affirmation, regardless of sexual orientation and gender, is in fact a requirement of Christian faithfulness. So if you don't do that, you're not being faithful to Jesus Christ. Now, most who make this claim that the church must receive into its fellowship those who are actively and impenitently engaging in homosexual conduct, most for now restrict that claim to those who are in committed monogamous relationships. In other words, they would say, no, we're not talking about only these people who are in committed monogamous relationships. We're saying that the church must accept them into its fellowship. But that doesn't do anything to lessen the gravity of this question for the church. Albert Moeller, who's the president of Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, he wrote earlier this year, a few months ago, evangelical Christians in the United States now face an inevitable moment of decision. While Christians in other movements and in other nations face similar questions, the question of homosexuality now presents evangelicals in the United States with a decision that cannot be avoided. Within a very short time, we will know where everyone stands on this question. There will be no place to hide, and there will be no way to remain silent. To be silent will answer the question. Now, ultimately, what is at stake in this conflict is Scripture's place in the life of the church. I want you to see that it's that significant. What is at stake in this conflict ultimately is Scripture's place in the life of the church. Will the Bible stand as an objective revelation from God, something to which the church conforms in its submission to Jesus? Or will the Bible be made to conform to the church? Be made to say whatever we want it to say? Now, in that case, the Bible ceases to be the Word of God, and it becomes the Word of man masquerading as the Word of God. You see, imputing our will to God under the guise of interpreting the Bible is an attempt to tame rather than serve Almighty God. Now, proponents of a homosexualist reading of Scripture, they never put the matter quite so plainly, but some of their statements reveal very clearly that their interpretations, driven not by a desire to hear the Bible, to hear what God is really saying in Scripture, but by a desire to justify a prior conclusion that homosexual conduct is not wrong. They are grasping, groping, searching for a way to dress their acceptance of homosexual conduct in biblical legitimacy. They've already concluded it's fine. Now they're going around and trying to construct something from the Bible and cobble something together that they can then say, you see, the Bible's, that's what the Bible says. And they're doing this in many different ways. Consider this example. It's from a blog post from April of 2013 by a young woman, Danica Nash. It's called "An Open Letter to the Church from My Generation." She writes, "My whole life I've been told again and again that Christianity is not conducive with," I think she means compatible with, "but is not conducive with homosexuality. It just doesn't work out. I was forced to choose between the love I had for my gay friends and so-called biblical authority. I chose gay people, and I'm willing to wager I'm not the only one." I said, if the Bible really says this about gay people, meaning that homosexual conduct is wrong, I'm not too keen on trusting what it says about God. And I left my church. It has only been lately that I've seen evidence that the Bible could be saying something completely different about love and equality. So here's a person who comes to a conviction, leaves the church over it, then says, well, what? You mean the Bible doesn't really say that after all? The Bible doesn't really say that after all? And is trying, you see, to find some way to justify a prior conclusion. The Catholic scholar, Luke Timothy Johnson, who changed his view after his daughter came out as a lesbian, he writes, "I think it's important to state clearly that we do in fact reject the straightforward commands of Scripture and appeal instead to another authority when we declare that same-sex unions can be holy and good." He then explains a bit later, or clarifies, "We appeal explicitly to the weight of our own experience and the experience thousands of others have witnessed to, which tells us that to claim our own sexual orientation is in fact to accept the way in which God created us." As Albert Moeller observes, he says, there are a great host of people, Hitachi. He says, there are a great host of people, this really isn't working down here either, I can see it, but there are a great host of people considered to be within the larger evangelical movement. Evangelical, think people who take the Bible seriously. There are a great host of people considered to be within the larger evangelical movement who are desperately seeking a way to make peace with the moral revolution and endorse the acceptance of openly gay individuals and couples within the life of the church. Given the excruciating pressures now exerted on evangelical Christianity, many people, including some high-profile leaders, are desperately seeking an argument they can claim as both persuasive and biblical. So what I want you to see is that there are people who are rummaging through the Bible, trying to make it fit something they want it to say. They are trying to conform the Bible to their prior conviction instead of sitting under the Bible and trying to hear what is God saying. That is how we are to approach the Word of God. What is God saying? I want to hear it. Not what can I make it say? And that's an important thing I want you to see. Now, those seeking to sanctify homosexual conduct, they're like those Paul described in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 and 4, who will not put up with sound teaching. They simply won't have it. Because they've already concluded that I'm not going to swallow that. I'm not going to accept that. They will not put up with sound teaching. Instead, he says in 2 Timothy, they accumulate teachers for themselves to satisfy their itching ears. I want people who will say what I want to say. I want them to craft these even bizarre arguments. Oh, yeah, that's right, that's right, that's right. And so they're just like those people that Paul speaks of there. They're like those Peter describes in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, who twist Paul's words to their own destruction as they do the other Scriptures. Now, as I'll show in the course of this study, Scripture clearly and uniformly condemns as sinful all forms of homosexual conduct. Scripture clearly and uniformly condemns as sinful all forms of homosexual conduct. In the words of Richard Hayes, who's a New Testament scholar and the dean of Duke Divinity School, certainly not a conservative institution. Richard Hayes says, well, I guess he's not going to say it here, is he? Oh, I got Richard Hayes up there. Maybe I can do it this way. He says, Scripture offers no loopholes or exception clauses that might allow for the acceptance of homosexual practices under some circumstances. Despite the efforts of some recent interpreters to explain away the evidence, the Bible remains unambiguous and univocal in its condemnation of homosexual conduct. Now, I want you to see some of these people, because one of the plays that's made is to say, that's just these, you know, small-minded, fundamentalist, know-nothing groups that think this. So I want you to see that's a lie. I want you to see, no. People recognize this. People like Hayes, people like Wolfhart Pannenberg. Now, Pannenberg is a renowned German theologian. He died a few months ago. He's often been called the greatest theologian of the second half of the 20th century. Pannenberg says, the biblical assessments of homosexual practice are unambiguous in their rejection, and all its statements on this subject agree without exception. Ben Witherington, who is a prolific New Testament scholar, he's a Methodist. Witherington says, the witness of the Bible is univocal about same-sex sexual activity. It is always rejected as sinful. There is no distinction made between homosexual behavior that is part of the consensual acts of adults and other forms of such behavior. For those who indeed intend to continue to recognize the Bible as the normative rule, not only for faith but for ethical practice in the church or the synagogue, we cannot be about the business of making anyone comfortable in their sin, whether a heterosexual or a homosexual person. We can't come in and say, okay, no, that's fine. For anybody. We're the Church of Christ. And we call people to holiness in living. And this isn't something that is only recognized by narrow, small-minded. That's the caricature you see. And you'll see that in some of the quotes that I'll give you from some of the homosexual activists in a minute. For the church to accept homosexual conduct or any form of sexual immorality in the life of a Christian is for the church to reject the lordship of Jesus Christ. It is for the church to commit spiritual suicide, to cease being the church. Let me quote Pannenberg, what Pannenberg has to say on that point. Well, I got the thing back up. How about that? Pannenberg says, the church has to live with the fact that in this area of life, as in others, departures from the norm are not exceptional, but rather common and widespread. We know we sin. Departures from the norm. The church must encounter all those concerned with tolerance and understanding, but also call them to repentance. It cannot surrender the distinction between the norm and behavior that departs from that norm. Here lies the boundary of a Christian church that knows itself to be bound by the authority of Scripture. Those who urge the church to change the norm of its teaching on this matter must know that they are promoting schism. They have to know that if you do this, many people are going to say, I'm out. I know that's wrong, and I don't care what you tell me, I know that's wrong. So they have to know they're promoting schism. If a church were to let itself be pushed to the point where it ceased to treat homosexual activity as a departure from the biblical norm and recognized homosexual unions as a personal partnership of love equivalent to marriage, such a church would stand no longer on biblical ground, but against the unequivocal witness of Scripture. A church that took this step would cease to be the one holy Catholic small c and apostolic church. That's right. That's what's at stake. That's why this is so important. Just a couple of weeks ago, Baptist scholar Russell Moore, he put it more succinctly in an article he wrote in First Things. He simply said, a church that accommodates itself to the sexual revolution is no longer a church of Jesus Christ. So that's what I'm telling you. A church that goes this route commits spiritual suicide. I don't care how many people they attract. I don't care what they're doing. They have ceased to be faithful to Christ and have cut themselves off from the Lordship of Jesus Christ and therefore have ceased to be a church. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul rebukes the church there. He rebukes the church there for tolerating in their midst a man engaging in sexual immorality. In that case, the particular sin was having sex with his stepmother. Paul insists that the man be disfellowshipped. He cannot be a part of the community living like that. He insists the man be disfellowshipped, and he instructs the saints not to associate with anyone who wears the name brother, but who is engaging in sexual immorality or various other sins. And he ends his discussion of the subject in 1 Corinthians 5, verse 13, drive out the wicked man from among you. This is the Spirit of God speaking through Paul. So do not tell me it's not loving. Okay? Don't twist the notion of love to where it is something that opposes the Spirit of God. If you're doing that, you have to understand that your concept of what it means to love is warped. This is what it means to love. And Paul says that. Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 3 through 5, that sexual immorality and all impurity and covetousness must not even be named among the saints. Meaning either these things should not occur even once in the community of faith. They shouldn't even be there at all. Or meaning that they shouldn't become acceptable subjects of conversation. He concludes in Ephesians 5, verse 5, no sexually immoral or impure or greedy person who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. That's pretty serious, isn't it? That's pretty serious. No sexually immoral or greedy person, impure or greedy person, has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Revelation chapter 2, verses 14 through 16, and Revelation chapter 2, verse 20, Jesus chastised, Jesus himself chastised the Christians in Pergamum and Thyatira for tolerating impenitent Christians in their midst. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 6, he praised the Christians in Ephesus for hating the sinful practices of the Nicolaitans, which he also hates. He praised them for that. You even say that. They hated the sinful practices, and Jesus says, that's well done. The practices that I also hate. We would go, oh, no, that can't be right. It is right. It is right. Now, those who encourage people to live in sexual immorality by assuring them that their conduct is not immoral, they should tremble at Jesus' words in Matthew 18, 6, that whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and to be drowned in the depth of the sea. And they likewise should be put in fear by Paul's rebuke in Romans chapter 1, verse 32, of those who approve of the wrong done by others. What we see occurring in society at large and in Christian denominations is the result of a deliberate and planned campaign over the last 40 years or so to mainstream homosexual conduct. Though homosexual activists, they bristle at the claim that there is a, quote, gay agenda that has been implemented through political process. They bristle at that and want you to think this is just some kind of natural, organic thing that just happened. And it wasn't part of an implemented scheme. But the evidence for this gay agenda is overwhelming. Much of it is documented in Michael Brown's book, A Queer Thing Happened to America. Now, the agenda began formulating as early as 1970. But in 1987, that produced a couple of important and revealing documents. September 1st, 1987, the nation's most prominent homosexual magazine. This wasn't something in a corner on the internet. The nation's most prominent homosexual magazine published an article by Steve Warren, who's a leader of the homosexual group ACT UP. And his article was titled, Warning to the Homophobes. And in that article, in the most prominent homosexual magazine in the country, Warren wrote, henceforth, homosexuality will be spoken of in your churches and synagogues and as an honorable estate. You can either let us marry people of the same sex or better yet, abolish marriage altogether. They've since taken another tact on that. You will be expected to offer ceremonies that bless our sexual arrangements. You will also instruct your people in homosexual as well as heterosexual behavior, and you will go out of your way to make certain homosexual youths, to make certain that homosexual youths are allowed to date, attend religious functions together, openly display affection, and enjoy each other's sexuality without embarrassment or guilt. If any of the older people in your midst object, you will deal with them sternly, making certain they renounce their ugly and ignorant homophobia or suffer public humiliation. You will also make certain that laws are passed forbidding discrimination against homosexuals and heavy punishments are assessed. Finally, we will in all likelihood want to expunge a number of passages from your scriptures and rewrite others, eliminating preferential treatment of marriage and using words that will allow for homosexual interpretation of passages describing biblical lovers such as Ruth and Boaz and Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. They need to read a little bit more. This says warning. He finishes, warning. If all these things do not come to pass quickly, we will subject Orthodox Jews and Christians to the most sustained hatred and vilification in recent memory. We have captured the liberal establishment and the press. We have already beaten you on a number of battlefields. You have neither the faith nor the strength to fight us, so you might as well surrender now. September 1987, a couple of months later, in November of 1987, two Harvard-trained homosexual writers, Marshall Kirk and Hunter Madsen, published an influential article titled The Overhauling of Straight America. That article was expanded into a book that was published in 1990, and it laid out a strategy. It laid out a strategy for a large-scale media campaign to change the image of homosexuals in America. And the authors declared that the campaign that they were proposing in November of 1987 needed to do the following six things, all of which you will recognize as having been accomplished. They said, talk about gays and gayness as loudly and as often as possible. Now, in that section, they say this. When conservative churches, you see, conservative, that's why I want you to see Pannenberg, Witherington, Richard Hayes, because what are they trying to do? They're trying to caricature the opposition, see, to say, it's only these old, these just narrow-minded, you know, just bitter people, okay? He says, when conservative churches condemn gays, there are only two things we can do to confound the homophobia of true believers. First, we can use talk to muddy the moral waters. This means publicizing support for gays by more moderate churches, raising theological objections of our own about conservative interpretations of biblical teachings, and exposing hatred and inconsistency. Second, we can undermine the moral authority of homophobic churches by portraying them as antiquated backwaters, badly out of step with the times and with the latest findings of psychology. Against the mighty pull of institutional religion, one must set the mightier draw of science and public opinion, the shield and sword of that accursed secular humanism. Such an unholy alliance has worked well against churches before on such topics as divorce and abortion. With enough open talk about the prevalence and acceptability of homosexuality, that alliance can work again here. Third point they make, they say portray gays as victims. Second one, portray gays as victims, not aggressive challengers. This is the second one they say. That has to be part of this large-scale media campaign. You see, this is why the media largely, almost completely, avoids images and stories of homosexuals that don't fit that mold. You see, when they're calling up and leaving messages on the phone of some religious guy in San Francisco threatening to kill him, you got to know where to find that. You're not going to find that in a story. When they're up here in these parades doing these kinds of things, you're not going to see that. Why? Because this is part of the strategy, you see. I'm feeding America a perspective and an image because I'm changing the culture, just like they said. And we're just bopping along going, no, I just think this is just kind of an organic movement of justice. You see, this is how this stuff works. This is how this works. He said third is, give homosexual protectors a just cause. Well, these guys weren't stupid, right? Do you see this? They weren't stupid. But it says, give homosexual protectors a just cause. This is what's behind the attempt to equate their situation with the civil rights struggle of African Americans. They are so invested in that analogy. They are so invested in that narrative that we are simply like the civil rights struggle of African Americans. They're so invested in that Crystal Dixon, an African American woman, was fired in 2008 from her job as Associate Vice President of Human Resources at the University of Toledo. She was fired for daring to express her opinion in an op-ed piece in the Toronto Free Press that homosexuality was not analogous to being black. She found the comparison offensive. And so she writes an op-ed piece, and the school fires her for that. Well, I'm telling you, that's this, you see. You can't disrupt that just cause because we need to bring in young people. It gives them a sense of a just crusade, you see. As it was noble for people to fight for the civil rights of African Americans, come on in, see, it's the same thing. Give them a cause, you see, and they've been very effective at that. The fourth thing they say is make gays look good. If you've turned on anything, watched any movies, seen any, you know that's right, right? As soon as I see somebody on there who's homosexual, I said, he's not the killer. I guarantee you he's not. Look for some guy with a cross. He'll be butchering people. But this is part of the media strategy and part of the campaign. Then they said the fifth thing, the point they made, is make the victimizers look bad. And in that section, they wrote, the public should be shown images of ranting homophobes whose secondary traits and belief disgust middle America. These images might include the Ku Klux Klan demanding that gays be burned alive or castrated, bigoted Southern ministers drooling with hysterical hatred to a degree that looks both comical and deranged, Menacing punks, thugs, and convicts speaking coolly about the fags they've killed or would like to kill. A tour of Nazi concentration camps where homosexuals were tortured and gassed. This was the idea. Make the victimizers look bad. Why do you think religious people look the way they do in all of these media things? It is because of this. It's part of this strategy that is being fulfilled. Now, this is what's behind labeling, by the way. This is what is behind labeling anyone who disagrees with them as hateful or homophobic. You can't simply have real convictions in your service to... No. If you disagree with me, ipso facto, you are hateful and homophobic. You see, that's a political tactic. It is a political tactic. A way of stigmatizing their opponents, you see, so average Americans will want to disassociate from them. If I can label you as a hater, isn't that one of the big words in our culture? Don't hate on me, man. Don't be a hater. So if I can stick that label on you, well, then I make you radioactive for people and nobody wants anything to do with you and I've successfully marginalized you. And that is what is, of course, is going on, you see? But I want to ask you, who really loves the homosexual? And I want you to think about that. Who really loves the homosexual? Is it the one who reinforces his defiance of God and thus helps to pave the road to his eternal condemnation? Or is it the one who exposes that defiance in hope that he or she will turn to Christ and find eternal life? Who is the one who loves the person? And to me, to ask that question is to answer it. As the Spirit wrote through Solomon many years ago in Proverbs 27:6, faithful are the wounds of a friend. Profuse are the kisses of an enemy. Who really loves the homosexual? Matthew chapter 22, verse 39. Jesus said the second greatest commandment is you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now that commandment comes from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, and the verse right before. In Leviticus chapter 19, verse 17, it contrasts hating your brother with rebuking him. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Right before that, the contrast is hating your brother and rebuking him. And the implication is that love demands correction of the erring. That's really what it means to love somebody. You don't let them go and fall off a cliff simply because you're afraid that if you tell them they're headed in the bridges out, they'll get mad at you. That's not love. That's quite frankly being a punk. It's not love at all. It's selfishness that says, listen, I'm more concerned about you thinking certain of me instead of really blessing your life and helping you. Our culture appreciates the nobility of so-called tough love. In other circumstances, we're dealing with a rebellious teenager, dealing with alcoholics, dealing with drug addicts. But under the influence of this homosexual agenda, we're now to the point that our society and culture, it demonizes tough love of homosexuals as homophobia. But my appeal to you is that the church cannot be intimidated. As Christ loved sinful humanity enough to endure public scorning in order to bless it. Look what he put up with. He endured public scorning in order to bless sinful humanity. We as Christ's disciples must love homosexuals enough to do the same. Those who come to the light will be forever grateful. And those who do not will know on that day that we really were acting for their best interest. We really were sacrificing our own view, how they looked at us, for them. We were doing it to bless them. We were willing to endure their scorn to bless them. They'll see that then, even if they don't see it now. The last point that they make is solicit funds. And they've been amazing at that. June 2nd, 2005, Wayne Besson, who's a founder of a pro-homosexual political organization, he wrote an article titled Visibility's Victory, and in which he listed things that people could do to further the homosexual movement. And his second item was, he said, if you're a person of faith, so he's talking to the church now, religious folk, let me put it that way. If you're a person of faith, don't let counterfeit Christians. So he's in the world of theology now, is he not? He's going to preach to me about what the Bible means. Okay, well, this is the world. Come on in. If we're going to talk about what the Bible says, that's what we're going to talk about. But he's saying here, if you're a person of faith, don't let counterfeit Christians like Jerry Falwell, James Dobson, and Pat Robertson hijack religion. Jesus never once mentioned homosexuality. Oh, we'll talk about that. Yet these phoniest of Pharisees are obsessed with the issue. If you're a Christian, whose priorities do you trust? Falwell's or Christ's? Now, what do you see here? You see, because these people who say it's sinful, these, you know, slope-headed, narrow-minded, can't think, stodgy, whatever these words are, how they're trying to marginalize people like that. Are you going to go with them, or are you going to go with Jesus? Meaning, Jesus disagrees with them. This is the message I'm telling you is being forced into religious bodies. The message is false, but it's not going to stop, okay? That message is not going to stop. Now, nobody thinks that all homosexuals share these goals and attitudes. Many are just living their lives day to day. I understand that, but these goals and attitudes are prominent among the activists who are driving the homosexual political and religious movement. These people are trying, among other things, to delegitimize and demonize the historic Jewish and Christian understanding of Scripture. And don't think that any group of believers is going to be immune. Without vigilance, all can be swayed by cultural trends. Some just more easily than others. Now, homosexuals have gone on the offensive. They've gone on the offensive demanding that the church embrace sexual immorality. That is the posture of my class. That is the focus I am taking. Somebody comes to the church and says, you must embrace and accept those who are actively and impenitently engaging in homosexual conduct. I say, wrong. Okay? That's what the class is. Is that claim true? Or is the claim that I'm making to you and that I showed you from Hayes and Pannenberg and Witherington? Is that claim true? Which is it? Does the Bible speak that way? Does the Bible speak with one voice that homosexual conduct is sinful? And indeed it does. Now, homosexuals, I say, they've gone on the offensive. They're attacking us by insisting that the unanimous understanding of Jews and Christians for thousands of years is wrong. And we have to defend the truth of God whenever smooth talkers confuse people. Right? When people come in and start saying, yeah, you know, this isn't right, this isn't. Well, when smooth talkers start confusing people, we have to defend the truth of God, and we should make no apology for doing it. On the contrary, righteous indignation is fitting when false teachers endanger the saints. What if somebody came in and started teaching something else? I'm not talking about here. I'm talking about religious groups generally. Well, you sit and say, well, who cares? No, when somebody comes in and starts smooth-talking and teaching something that endangers the saints, then we have to respond. We have to call this for what it is. The embracing of sexual immorality is heresy. It is heresy, and we must, in love, rebuke those who contradict sound doctrine. Do we not? Yes. We have to, in love, rebuke those. Now, I'm well aware that since the 1960s, homosexuals have referred to themselves as gay. You know, I haven't been oblivious to that. I know that, but I prefer the descriptive term homosexual, same sex, over their euphemism. Because the euphemism carries the false connotation that the homosexual lifestyle is a kind of merry and carefree and fun-filled existence. That's not true. And I don't want to encourage the false perception. Why should I help propagandize a way of life that draws people from God? So I use the neutral term. And somebody says, I don't think it's neutral. Well, look, the language is same sex. That's what it means. And I'm not going to let you shift me over into using your euphemism because you say I want you to use it. So that's it. I'm not using it in a derogatory sense. I'm using it descriptively as same sex. But I wanted you to know I'm aware of that. Now, I titled the class The Bible and Homosexual Conduct because the question is not whether the church should receive into its fellowship those who simply are attracted to those of the same sex. One who experiences an involuntary impulse or desire to do something forbidden by God has not thereby sinned. Rather, he or she is being tempted to sin. As James says in James chapter 1, verses 14 and 15, rather, each man is tempted by being dragged away and enticed by his own desires, then the desire, after conceiving, gives birth to sin. If unchecked, you see, if unchecked, our desire to do wrong will lead beyond temptation into actual sin. But the mere desire, you see, this desire here, this involuntary impulse or desire is to do wrong, is not the same as doing wrong. And I think that's important to understand. The desire to do wrong, it only gives birth to sin when a person chooses to yield to that desire. And in the sexual realm, that may be by lusting in one's heart. That may be by lusting in one's heart or physically engaging in illicit sexual relations. Let me give you an example. Let's say there's a person who has an involuntary attraction to his sister or to another man's wife. He sees her and it's like, wow, she's hot. You see? However you want to do that. But let's say that person does that. You see, he hasn't sinned by virtue of the attraction, but if he pursues that desire in his heart, if he fantasizes about it, if he makes plans to move it along or to act on it, well, then he's done something, he's sinned in his heart. Or if he actually engages in sexual activity with the woman. You see, then his desire, in the terminology of James 1, has then blossomed into sin. And I think that's an important distinction. And the same goes for a man or woman with same-sex attraction. Now, the question, of course, I'm trying to hurry because I see about finished and I only got a little bit to go and I want to get it out. So I'm talking like the guy in the old commercial. Just stick with me. But look, the question is not whether God loves homosexuals. That's not the question. God, of course, loves homosexuals. The cross of Jesus Christ proves forever, forever, the depth of God's love for all mankind. His love for homosexuals is not in doubt one iota. The question is, will the homosexual love God? That's the question. You see, because you cannot love God and live in defiance of His commands. I don't care what you say about your emotions and how you feel. You don't know what love for God is if you think you can love Him and live in rebellion to Him. You cannot. You cannot. Oh, but I have this one. I'm talking if you love me, You will keep my commandments. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. You are my friends if you do what I command. Whoever says I know him but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth's not in him. You get the idea. The question is not whether God loves the homosexual. The question is whether the homosexual will love God. Now, I'm going to be going into, I'm going to be going into a fair amount of detail in the class. People say, is this going to be 2 weeks? No, it's going to be seven, maybe. Eight, I don't know. People say, how can that possibly be? Okay? But it's necessary, you see, in my judgment, to expose the sophistry of those who are pushing the homosexual agenda. You know, they don't have a leg to stand on, but if you don't know the details, then you don't know why their claims are defective. You see, if you don't know why, if you don't know what is it they're claiming, how are they going to come after my kids? What are they going to say in justification of this claim that to be a Christian you have to embrace impenitent homosexuality? Well, you have to know those. And then you have to be able to see why they're defective. Otherwise, you remain vulnerable, and you also are not able to help others see through the smoke. Okay? So this just takes time. It's not like I talk slow. Okay? But it takes time, and there's a lot of stuff to talk about. All right? Class over. Thanks.